les troisièmes Jeux Olympiques de la jeunesse d'hiver à Lausanne.
We welcome you to the home of the Olympic movement.
Tous nos rêves seront là.
Three, we wanna reach the top.
Great to see the spirit and camaraderie between the athletes. That is what the Youth Olympic Games is all about.
You're ready?
Yeah!
You're really ready?
Yeah!
Take that! Well done, Noah!
Hey guys, what's up? Welcome to the Olympic Channel Live Show. This is the pre-show as we warm up for our show, which is coming up very shortly with some fantastic interviews and some highlights from the action here at the Youth Olympic Games in Lausanne. I'm Ash Tulloch, and we are bringing you the action on our website, olympicchannel.com. You can also catch the highlights, find out about our blog, the lowdown, and you can also find out about our podcast. It's great to have you guys with us, and we want to know where you are in the world. So make sure you send us your comments and also get involved in our question, because today we are asking, what is the most extreme winter sport? You've got a few options, so have a think about it and make sure you send us in some messages. I think we've already had some messages come on in. Have we got some comments? What sport do you think is the most extreme? Giovanni says downhill is extreme. I agree. And we also have a message saying ski jumping is kind of crazy. I think that it's super crazy, very extreme. Frankie's saying figure skating is very extreme. I'm going to ask some athletes, because they're sitting down here, and see what they think is extreme. But before we do, let's say a little hello to Viktor Knoch, who is upstairs waiting to come down and join us. He is an Olympic champion from Pyeongchang. We're going to be talking to him about short track speed skating. It's extreme, and we're going to be talking to him about that very shortly. Wow. Before we talk to him, let's talk to some athletes who are kindly sitting down here. What are you guys playing? You look like you're playing some sort of game.
No, we are just like trying to collect the things you can, the pins. We are just hanging out in the village, which is extremely cool.
I didn't get your name. What was your name, sorry, and where are you from?
My name is Lubomir. I'm from Bulgaria, and this is my teammate.
I'm Alexander. I'm from Bulgaria too.
Cool, and you guys have just arrived because there are two waves of athletes.
Yeah.
So the first have already gone and you guys have just arrived.
Yes.
What's it like so far?
So far it's very cool. That's probably the biggest forums we've ever been to, and I'm really looking to go to the big Olympics.
What sport are you competing in?
I'm a short track speed skater, as you said earlier, and I guess that's a very interesting sport. You can ask my teammate, he's cross country.
I'm cross country skiing. Yeah, it's a bit difficult, but I love it.
How extreme is cross country?
Well, the distance is not that extreme, but we have a sprint, which is high speed, and it's really extreme. Like, tomorrow we have ski cross, which has jumps, it has a lot of downhills, it has slalom. Like, it's really extreme, actually. It's a lot of high speed.
How do you deal with the fear then? Do you get scared?
Sorry?
How do you deal with the fear? Do you get scared?
Well, yeah, I get scared. I'm actually scared of jumping with skis, but I don't know what we'll do tomorrow. We'll see.
And what about for you, mate? When it comes to being on the ice, it seems very physical. It's not just gently, you know, skating around the rink.
Our sport, you shouldn't block other players. You shouldn't touch them, other skaters. The only extreme part, I guess, is that you can crash into the boards. But if there are no boards, like here in Lausanne, it's very good. And then you don't have fear of crashing. So I guess you can do your best to skate.
Have you had a chance to meet any other people from any other countries?
So far, we just arrived yesterday, so we didn't have that much time. But now we're exploring. We guess we want to make new friendships, and we'll see.
You mentioned before about the Olympics, so the Youth Olympics is kind of the first big step. How do you feel about being here?
Well, I'm so amazed and I'm glad that my country chose me to represent the country. I'm really grateful. I want to thank my parents too.
Yeah, give a shout out to Mum and Dad. Look down the camera.
Yeah, shout out to Mum and Dad. I love you so much. Yeah. I'm so proud that I've come to here. I wasn't thinking about coming at Olympic Games. I was skiing for fun, and then it happened it was my habit. And yeah, I'm competing seriously now. And I'm looking forward to the big Olympics. This is the warm-up for the big Olympics.
You guys are serious. I really appreciate that.
Yeah.
Hey, teach me something. How do I say hello in Bulgarian?
You can say zdravei. Zdravei?
Zdravei.
Yeah. It's just like that. That means hello.
Okay.
Yeah, and good morning is dobro utro.
Yeah, I'm not going to try that one.
Yeah, it's tough. Our language is really tough.
Yeah, but the cool thing about being here is you're probably going to be able to talk to a lot of other people.
Yeah, that's the coolest thing, that we can meet a lot of countries. There is 40 countries maybe, or even more. And that's the coolest part. We can meet everyone all around the world. And yeah. It's the most amazing thing.
Yeah, it's cool. I was talking to a South African athlete the other day who had never actually been on an aeroplane until he'd come to the Youth Olympic Games. So there's some really cool people and some really cool stories. Have you had a chance to sort of network, or have you been really focused on
As I said, we just came yesterday. So now we are looking forward to meeting new people, meeting the new countries, the people from other countries. There are some stories, very interesting, I guess. And we'll see what happens in this week. I want it to be very interesting and just have fun here.
Cool. Well, thank you guys so much for hanging out with us. This is our pre-show. So very shortly, we're going to jump into our live show and we're going to catch up with Viktor Knoch, who is a gold medalist in your sport, actually. You know him?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's very good. We're going to catch up with him. If you guys have got any questions for him, then make sure that you fire those questions to us. Of course, our question of the day is, what is the most extreme winter sport? Let us know, write in the comments, and tell us where in the world you are joining us from. Thank you guys so much for joining us. I feel like I should let you go and have some dinner and eat some food and get rested before tomorrow. All the very best. Good luck.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And good luck learning some new languages out there. So before we get into the action, I want to remind you that you can enjoy the action and you can also see the highlights on olympicchannel.com. So far, we have had a lot of medals awarded. It is day 8. The 5-a-side ice hockey has started and you can enjoy watching that on our website. So make sure you do. Make sure you stay tuned because our live show is coming up very soon. What's up, guys? Hello and welcome to day 8 of the Youth Olympic Games right here in Lausanne, Switzerland. I'm Ash Tulloch and we are bringing you the action. We are bringing you highlights. We're bringing you interviews right here on the Olympic Channel. It's great to have you with us wherever you are in the world. Let us know. Let us know where you are joining us from. We've got some coaches. We've got some Ukrainians in the crowd, some people just sitting here joining us. One very big camera, which brings me to the fact that you guys can enjoy the action on our website, on our app, and you can also find out about our podcast, about the lowdown, and every day we are live blogging, so you can get a bit more of an insight as to what is going on behind the scenes at this Youth Olympic Games. We have a special guest who I'm looking forward to chatting to very shortly. Viktor Knoch from Hungary is sitting and waiting to come down. He, of course, is an Olympic champion in short track speed skating from Pyeongchang 2018. So he knows what it's like to compete at an event like this, and he's been very successful. We are also asking you guys what you think the most extreme winter sport is. What do you think? Send us a comment, let us know. We've already had some comments and things coming through, so let's see what you have been saying. What sport? Jonathan says most extreme winter sport is probably luge / skeleton. We're going to look a little bit more into that later, so stay tuned for that. Luke is saying the most extreme sport is skeleton. All right, I'm sensing a little bit of a theme here. Super G or ski jump is pretty extreme. Ice hockey is the most aggressive for sure. I think a lot of people would probably agree with the contact that goes on with the ice hockey. And if you didn't hear me in our pre-show, then you may not know that the ice hockey, the five-a-side ice hockey has started, and you can watch that on the Olympic Channel website. Now, if you want to know a little bit more about what is going on at this Youth Olympics, then stay and watch this, because Anais Kuraduchi has been showing us around this Youth Olympic Village. She was an athlete who was here last week. She has left, but she made us this wonderful video. She filmed it, she created it. So have a look at this. Nice work there from Anais, who filmed that video herself. So fantastic stuff. Athletes are getting involved and doing a lot of fun things, not just playing sport here. Of course, she was one of the athletes who was in the first wave of competitors who came and competed here at the Youth Olympic Games. The second wave have already arrived, so they're making themselves comfortable in this Youth Olympic Village, which is where we are, where we're filming right now. Now, our team are out and about covering this Youth Olympic Games in every possible way, and Andrew is in St Moritz because the Olympia Bob Run is where competition has started in the luge. But why is it so special? Have a look.
Hi guys, Andrew here at turn 6 of the St Moritz Olympia Bob Run, also known as Horseshoe Corner, where luge, skeleton and monobob athletes can reach speeds of 120 kilometers an hour. You might even see one coming past me very soon. I'm lucky to be joined by Hallie, a skeleton athlete from Canada here, who's going to explain to us how it feels to go around Horseshoe Corner.
It's definitely a little nerve-wracking because this is the biggest, like most difficult corner on the track, but it's a lot of fun getting up in those speeds.
And do you ever feel it? Here it goes. Wow. It seems like there's a lot of pressure on you. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so because the speeds in the big corner, you definitely feel a lot of pressure, so your face can get smushed into the ice. But it's a good feeling because you know you're going fast.
Wow, you're a lot braver than me, Hallie.
Yeah, she certainly is. Good on her, and all the very best for her competition. I don't know about getting face smashed. That sounds very aggressive and very extreme, which reminds me about our theme of the day, which of course is which is the most extreme winter sport. So make sure you keep sending in those messages. We're now going to have a look at some action from the luge. Congratulations to Germany, who won double gold. Teamwork makes the dream work. Good on you guys. Well done. Congratulations. Now, as I mentioned, we do have a theme for the day, and the question is, which is the most extreme winter sport? What do you think? I'm going to go with ski jumping. Never done it in my life, but I think that it definitely is the most extreme. You guys at home have been sending in your comments. We've got one there saying, Pratik from India saying, I think the most extreme sport is ice hockey. What about another message there saying biathlon? Pew pew swoosh. I like it, sound effects as well. Stella says ski cross, good on you Stella. And Francesca says opening the fridge can also be a dangerous winter sport. Yeah, it can be a little bit cold and a little bit slippery if you're sliding on in. All right, let's bring down our guest for the show today, Viktor Knoch, who is an Olympic champion from Pyeongchang in short track. How's it
Hi,
going?
Thank you. Good, thank you.
Did you see as you walked down there was some footage of you
competing?
Here we go.
Yeah.
What's going on? Oh, wow. What's this for a celebration?
That's an interesting story. Usain Bolt posted a video on his Instagram before the games that if anybody does his victory pose on top of the podium, he would send those people champagne. So Xiao Wang actually saw this video and showed it to us while we were waiting for the podium ceremony, the mascot ceremony actually. And we just instantly agreed to do it and we didn't regret it. It was a really iconic moment and it's been in the Hungarian media ever since. And we got the champagne as well.
I was about to say, did he follow through with
it? Yeah, he followed through. He sent the champagne with a written letter and signed that congratulating us on the Olympic gold.
Success would have been extra sweet, it sounds like.
Yeah.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us. What have you made of Lausanne 2020 so far?
I've only been here a couple of days, but it's amazing. I took part in 4 Winter Olympic Games, the previous 4, and it really resembles the big Winter Olympic Games. It's really the same, like the vibe, the Olympic Village, the volunteers, everybody's super helpful. I went inside the city today, everything's decorated with the same colors as the Olympic villages. So I think it's a really, really good experience, learning experience for the young kids to be a little bit better prepared for the Winter Olympic Games if they reach that point in their career.
South Korea has traditionally been the team that has been the big powerhouse in short track. Are other countries catching up?
Yeah, definitely. Europe started catching up. 5-6 years ago, the Netherlands and Russia following them, they caught up pretty fast to the top of the sport, and we did as well. You know, we won the Olympics, we won World Cups before, we podiumed on World Championships. So they have it's a really, really close competition when it comes down to the gold medals. And if you check the World Cup results, it really varies which country takes away the medals and which country wins. So the lead that they had about a decade ago is really diminishing, and it's a really level playing field in that regards.
I want to ask you about one of the iconic names in short track, Stephen Bradbury from Australia, who obviously unexpectedly won the gold medal at Salt Lake in 2002. How much luck is involved in your sport?
Well, in his case, it was like mostly luck, right? Like, if you can see this video, it's insane that he's so much behind and still wins. But this is, you know, this is one in a million. Usually I say that the luck you need is not to be unlucky. You know, because someone fell here and he took away everybody else. And if you're that, and if everybody else, you're one of the other guys who didn't do anything wrong, somebody just, you know, swept you off your feet and you couldn't do anything, and you still finished last or fourth and, you know, didn't get to the podium. So if you're lucky enough not to be unlucky, that's kind of enough. And then there are extreme cases, of course, where people get, you know, it's just, or the stars aligned, I guess, and it was his day to shine.
So when it comes to collisions and chaos like that, how often do athletes get injured? Because those blades are sharp.
Yeah, those blades are sharp. I wouldn't say it's very often that people get injured. They tend to get injured from time to time. I got a cut on my back going into Olympics at one of the last Olympic qualifiers. A Korean guy fell on top of my back and he punctured my back basically with the top of his blades. Last year there were a couple of cuts. I was a Korean skater who got his wrist cut really bad. It was a really serious cut and I think he missed the last part of the season because of it. You know, but it's part of the sport. It's what makes it exciting, makes it, you know, an extreme winter sport in my opinion. Because there's a lot of collisions and you really have to stay on top of your game, not to lose your balance, fight back, but not to be too aggressive. So it's in the sport.
You touched on extreme, and before we get to that, I want to ask you a question from one of the viewers, which is, how do you manage muscular equilibrium since you always turn in the same direction?
That's a very good question, and it's very important to do special exercises to focus on your muscle equilibrium, to use his words. Because if you want to have a long career, it's really important to take care of your muscles and your body so you don't get injured, you know, if you want to compete in a high level for 10, 15 years. So what we do is we can't skate to the other direction because our whole blades and skates, everything's set up to skate left. So what you can do is you can do dryland exercises, core exercises, back muscle exercises to make sure that both of your sides are, well, they're not going to be equally strong because that's just not going to happen because you skate all the time to the left, but yeah. To, you know, fix it a little bit and focus on staying healthy, really.
So a lot of work off the ice then?
Yeah, you can only practice that off the ice.
Yeah, you can't live on the ice the whole time.
No.
Mehdi is asking, how are speed skates different from hockey and figure skates? That's a good question.
They're completely different. when you want to get your speed skates done, you have to go to a specialist who takes your mold and they make your feet out of that mold and they really build the carbon fiber and with the epoxy on that mold, and it's really only good for your own feet. So it's like a Cinderella shoe, right? That it's only good for you. You can't sell them. You can't give it to someone else usually. So it's very specifically made for you. It's very, very stiff from some carbon fiber, which is the same material as Formula One cars. And the blades you buy separately and you have to screw it on the shoe. In short track, you have to have it fixed on two points on the shoe. And it's a long blade. It's, I don't know how many centimeters, but it's 17.5 inches usually for
right.
The men's and 17.0 for women. And it's a very thin blade. It's 1.1 millimeter thick and very, very sharp. It's bent to the corner and has a radius so you can turn with it. So everything's set up very, very specifically and very specially just for you, just for every single skater have a different setup.
Yeah, it's very, very technical, isn't it?
Yeah, it's very technical. And usually the big teams have technicians with them, so the skaters don't have to do it themselves anymore because it's a lot of work having everything right all the time.
Yeah, also very extreme, very extreme. Like I feel like I'm feeling like it more and more could be the winner of our question today, which is, what is the most extreme winter sport? We decided to put this question to some athletes, to some fans. We went to the snow to find out what they had to say.
to me, I'd say Super G, like skiing, is the most insane Winter Olympic sport because, you know, when you see them come through those turns, one little slip up and they're just gonna go flying.
The most extreme Olympic sport is luge because it's the fastest. My brother and my sister are competing. It's very dangerous if you fall, and it's impressive to see these young athletes going that fast. So yeah, cheers to all of them. And
I think luge because it's going so fast, and if you do a little bit mistake, you can fall or lose a lot of time. And if you fall, it can be dangerous.
Ski jumping because kind of the height that you get and the distance you go just in the air, it's pretty insane.
Luge because it's 80 miles an hour and no brakes.
Definitely luge because if you've seen some of those crashes, it's insane. Speed skating because it's very strategic and also it can be very physical.
Luge because there's nothing between the slider and the ice wall except a skinny little speed suit.
I think the most extreme is double seater luge because they are so fast and a lot of more over the ice, and so they must balance it all the time, and yeah, this is extreme too.
Gold medalist there from 2010, Tatiana Hafner from Germany. Obviously, she's going to go with her sport, isn't she? I'll ask you that question very shortly about what you think the most extreme sport is. But before we get into that, I want to look into a little bit more of the preparation that people do before they go out and compete. Because we saw a video today of some athletes from Kazakhstan, if we can pull it up now, warming up and preparing for their race. So what are they doing here?
So it's a pretty basic exercise. Every athlete does that in short track speed skating. It's a corner exercise. You go on dry land and you imitate your corner movements. You can slow them down, you can speed them up depending on what you want to practice.
Right.
And you know, because somebody's holding you, you can stop your motions, and really the coach can correct where your shoulders should be, where your hips should be, which way you should push. So it's a dry land training, and it's a corner exercise, what they were doing there. Everybody does that, honestly. I did it all day long.
Standard.
I did it all day long.
Yeah. Standard.
Yeah, it is.
So
it is.
Let's go through something.
Yeah, so we can't do that because we don't have belts, and I'm not sure who I would trust to hold me in that position, because if
enough.
Somebody, you know, makes a mistake, I'm the one falling in that exercise.
Okay.
So what we can do is that we can practice the other part. This is a straightaway, obviously, not the corner, which is a similar exercise. You go down to the skating position, and then you kind of want to push to the side,
back.
Right?
Yeah,
you go down on this leg.
All right, so
right?
Coming
like
here.
This. Yeah. Deep as you can, and then you push to the side. Yeah, you're doing okay.
All right.
You're trying to push your hip forward. Yeah.
I feel like I want to dance. Okay, hang on, let's do it one more time. Let's do it
one
again.
One more time, yeah.
So, okay. This is
so
the
you,
starting
so you
position.
Lean that one, yeah. And then you push. Yeah, you're trying to push to the side, push as big as you can. Just stay low, have really long glides, really long pushes. The lower you are, the longer your pushes, the faster you go. The harder to exercise.
Yeah, I'm feeling like I'm very uncoordinated. We're going to keep trying to work out how to do this. Well, I'm going to keep trying to work out how to do this. You guys check out our moment of the day. This is our Olympic. Okay.
Right, you want to use your body weight into the push, so you.
So you want to use your body weight.
Yeah, you want to like lean into the pushes.
So I feel like if you've got strong glutes, that probably helps.
Oh, yeah, that's why all the speed skaters have the big legs, right? Because
yeah.
All the dry land imitation and weight training that we do.
I'm going to catch my breath and ask you: are you okay if we put you on the stool behind me and give you a few quick fire questions?
Well, do I have a choice?
Yeah, no, not really. You
yeah,
up
okay.
for it?
Yeah, I'm up
okay,
for it. Yeah,
let's go.
Let's do it.
So let's walk up over here. You jump up on the stool. And why don't we change the mood a little bit? Oh, here we go, dun, dun, dun. And if you can look down to cameraman Kike, give us a big wave, Kike.
Okay.
All right. Are you sweating?
No, not yet.
All right, so look down there. The first question is, who is your most fierce rival?
My most fierce rival? I had J.R. Salsky, who we skated together for the longest time. I would say mostly he beat me, but I managed to beat him a couple of times. He's a multiple Olympic medalist.
Athlete you would most like to coach?
Athlete I most like to coach? Oh, that's a really good question. I would coach my former teammates, Liu Xiaowang. He's a young guy, very, very talented, very agile, amazing skater.
Favorite Lausanne 2020 sport?
Short track speed skating is the best sport.
What is your biggest fear?
My biggest fear? Oh, I don't know. Maybe jumping off the ski hill.
If you were a superhero, what would your power be?
What would my power be? I would like to be fast, so I would say Flash would be my ideal superhero.
If you were a pizza topping, which one would you be and why?
I would be a pepperoni, because that's the one that people love the most.
Good explanation. And last one, there's been a new color introduced to the Olympic rings. This is just a hypothetical question, by the way, disclaimer. There's been a new color introduced to the Olympic rings. Which color do you pick and why?
Which color? Oh, I would pick purple maybe. Blue's my favorite color, and I feel like purple is kind of close to it, so I would choose purple.
All right, fair enough. Easy, well done, give it up.
Thank you.
All right, now we are going to have a look at a very, very special track. Olympic silver medalist, rather, from Pyeongchang, Chris Master, went and saw how the luge track in St. Moritz was made. It's good.
What we are witnessing is the only hand-cut track in the world being built. Hi everyone, my name's Chris Master, 2018 Olympic silver medalist in the sport of luge. I am in St. Moritz, Switzerland. This is the fastest, smoothest track in the world. All right, so we're currently at the end of where they're working. And now what they're doing is they're dumping snow off of the road to build the next corner. So what's amazing is that in just 3 weeks, they're able to shape 1,700 meters of track, where before it looked like nothing, and right here you have a perfect curve. They don't have any electronic markers that tell them where to put the curves. They use the trees, the rocks, and it's hand-built every year. In order to build a track, you need snow and you also need ice. So that's what they're doing here. They're watering all of the snow that they just piled on to create slush. What they're then gonna do is shape the track. And when it gets really cold at night, it's gonna freeze. And that's gonna be the basis for the track. And I better move, because I'm about to get snow dumped on me. Just about 2 hours ago, none of this was here. It was just a giant snowbank. And now they've started to construct what actually looks like a curve, because they only have 3 weeks to turn just a normal hill into the world's best luge track.
Super impressive. I can't believe that they make that themselves. Is that something you would ever be interested in trying?
Interested maybe. Doing it, not so sure.
So we can't send you to St. Moritz and...
No, I don't think I'm going to go down on the loop anytime soon.
Too dangerous, too extreme.
Yeah. No,
So I can put it to you now. What do you think is the most extreme winter sport?
I think ski jumping is a very, very good guess. It looks extremely dangerous, and I don't know. I would never go down that ski hill for sure. But I think, you know, the snowboard freestyle race is bigger, and half pipes are also very extreme and very dangerous. You know, one small mistake and broken limbs everywhere.
Yeah, I feel like as soon as you start getting height involved, things get a little bit scary.
Yeah,
we've had lots of comments coming through. Trudy's saying skeleton, we've heard that quite a bit. We've got freestyle skiing is very dangerous and very extreme. But Shu Fenho says skimo. Have you seen skimo before? It's ski mountaineering,
no.
The new sport.
Ski mountaineering.
The new sport. They call it skimo, but it's the new sport.
It doesn't look such extreme.
Well, don't tell them that.
Okay.
All right, so let's have one more go. Can you take me through anything else that you would do in preparation for a short track race?
Yeah, so we have a little simpler exercises that are more like one movement, not so many movements at the same time. So what we do is we step on the ledge of something, and then you again just go down to the skating position, and then you can do up downs, and it's just it's really just a strength exercise. It's not very hard technically, you know, but when you have to do 4x20 or 5x20 or whatever your coach decides is the daily dose of your exercise, it can be quite hard and shaky on the legs.
What about you, mate? Can we get you to have a go at this? You've got to go? Okay, well, I'm just going to end up having to do it, aren't I?
No one else.
All right, so basically I'm just... So it's just... This is not good because I have a dodgy knee. So I'm just going down like this. How far down do I need to go?
Well, as low as you can.
But then what if I can't get back up?
Oh, that's nice. Yeah, that's not bad. Keep your body weight a little forward. You don't want to sit on your heel.
Keep the body weight forward.
Yeah, so you don't want to like, sit on your heel. You want to keep it forward and...
Actually, that's a good question.
Yeah, that's not bad.
When you're actually racing, when you're starting at the start line, where are you looking? Are you looking down or are you looking up?
I think it varies. Everybody has their own system of what they're doing. I tend to focus on looking forward because somebody taught me that that's what you're supposed to do, looking where you want to be and where you want to get fastest.
Yeah, they do say that, like with race car drivers, they say, look where you want to go.
Yeah, exactly. So that's my focus. You know, I always look at the first block. That's where I want to get before everybody else gets there optimally.
Yeah.
Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't.
We've got another question, I think, that we can throw to you. So if we pull that up, Alex Cool says, why do speed skaters touch the floor in turns? Well, but you got gloves on.
Yeah, you got gloves on and you have fingertips, special fingertips from plastic or carbon fiber, whatever, so your gloves don't get shredded from touching the ice. It's really just a balance thing because you lean so much in speed skating, short track speed skating, that it's like you really just do this and you touch the ice. And it's really just a little balancing thing. It's nothing else.
You also have something around your neck as well, don't you?
But you got a neck guard because, you know, there's sharp blades involved and you don't want to get your arteries cut and then have a serious accident. So you're obligated to wear cut-proof protection from the neck till the ankle on every single major arteries and veins.
Right.
But for example, the Hungarian skin suit is just arteries and veins. It's everywhere from neck till the ankle. So we go a little above of what's required minimally.
You're making a really good point of making it sound like the most extreme sport, that's for sure. Hey, we've got one more question coming through. Greg Mellon saying, what's the difference between short track and long track speed skating?
Well, one of the sports makes you fall asleep and one makes you stand on your toes when you're watching it, and I don't have to say which one's which, right? You know, long track, you race against the clock in a really big 400 meter track, while short track, it's much shorter, much more turns, and you race against other people. You have to pass, you have to defend. There's falls, there are crashes, there are very tight finishes. It's a very different sport.
It feels like you have a little bit of bias maybe towards your
sport,
but fair enough.
No, I don't think so. I think I'm as objective as anybody could be.
Well, they did get to go the skating for the long track. They got to do it on a lake, so that was pretty cool.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, yeah.
All right, well, why don't we do a little bit more of this? If you can just give us one more demo to finish off the show.
Okay.
So if you can just do the same one that you did before. So for those guys out there, if you wanna get your head around how to train for short track, this is how you do it. An Olympic champion. We're gonna let him finish it off for us. We are going to see you again tomorrow. Jump on OlympicChannel.com to see our live blog, catch up on the podcast and the action. We'll see you then. Take it away.
I can do that money, you know.